Hey, what's going on everyone? I'm the one and only, and I got an interesting video for you all today. As some of you may know, Apple Silicon MacBooks are far ahead of the competition. The M1 set the bar extremely high when it initially debuted, and now, Apple has slowly been upgrading some of their machines with the newest iteration of Apple Silicon, the M2 chip, coming in its multiple variations, including the M2 Pro and the M2 Max. The 15-inch MacBook Air was only recently released, and it comes packed with the M2 chip, but many may be wondering, do I need to upgrade if I already have an M1 machine? Well guys, in this video, I put the newest 15-inch M2 Air against my main production machine, my M1 Max 16-inch MacBook Pro that is fully spec'd out all except the storage. Now, of course, clearly this isn't apples to apples. I mean, it is technically since they're MacBooks, but you know what I mean. One has a Max chip and the other is a standard M2 chip, but still, I wonder to myself, is the M2 chip any faster than my 16-inch MacBook Pro with the M1 Max? Well, we're gonna find out in this video with a variety of stress tests, benchmarks, as well as some real-world testing to see how the standard M2 chip stacks up against my mighty M1 Max 16-inch Pro. I think the results will surprise you. Both of these machines will be plenty capable for 98% of consumers. The only time you should be upgrading to a Pro model or a chipset with the Pro or Max moniker is if you're a content creator, use your laptop for work or a hobby, or if you happen to do a lot of 3D rendering, just to name a few. And before we start, do me a solid and drop a like on this video, as I'm sure you're in for a treat looking at the performance of these two beasts head to head. All right, enough with the intros. Let's go ahead and get started and get into some benchmarks. All right, ladies and gentlemen, both the 15-inch Air and 16-inch Pro have a similar footprint. Both are larger versions of their smaller counterparts, the 13-inch Air and the 14-inch Pro respectively. But the Pro is a little thicker and has a ton more I/O, useful for professionals to be able to plug and play more efficiently rather than having to rely on a lot of dongles. So hardware-wise, the Pro already has an edge up. So, alright, let's start with some classic benchmarking, starting off with Geekbench 6. Many times, it's a good idea to gauge at your computer's potential by running a few benchmarks, and Geekbench reigns supreme as the go-to for most people. So first, we run a standard single and multi-core test. Now, if I were to guess, even before testing, I would have imagined the M2 chip should be on par, if not slightly outperform the M1 Max in single core, but not multi-core. This is due to each iterative upgrade typically being better optimized to handle single-threaded applications that don't necessarily draw too much power and don't rely on the GPU at all for help. Think of applications like typing up a Word document or a spreadsheet. So in this test, I was right with the standard M2 scoring a bit higher on single with 2613 versus the M1 Max's 2391. However, the M1 Max completely obliterated the newer M2 Air, coming in roughly 25% higher with a multi-core score of 12,425 versus 9,920 on the 15-inch Air, signaling to us that the M1 Max should be better equipped for things like rendering, editing, and gaming. But we need more information before we can make any conclusive opinions. Staying on Geekbench, now let's test an OpenCL test and a Metal test. During an OpenCL test, the performance of the system's OpenCL framework is evaluated, which assesses how well the device can handle parallel computing tasks using OpenCL programming languages and APIs. And in a Metal graphics test conducted by Geekbench, the device's capability to handle advanced graphics rendering and compute tasks using Apple's Metal framework is assessed, providing insights into its graphics processing power and efficiency. So here, since we're testing many facets of the computer, I think the M1 Max should still come out on top, and sure enough, it did. Here are my results. The regular M2 chip found on the 15-inch Air scored impressive results, but looks diminutive compared to the mighty M1 Max. Here, the M1 Max outshines the M2, scoring nearly 68,000 on OpenCL and almost 100,000 on Metal, basically telling us that the M1 Max clearly demonstrates its superiority in handling demanding tasks related to parallel computing and advanced graphics rendering. Okay, enough with Geekbench, but now still chugging along with some raw benchmarks. Let's now head over to Cinebench R23, an application designed to measure the performance of a computer's hardware components, specifically focusing on the CPU's ability to handle intensive rendering tasks using Maxon Cinema 4D software engine. This is one of the tests that lasts the longest and very much pushes these computers to their limits. This test has both computers feel hot to the touch and even fires up the fan on the Pro model. But remember, the Air has a fanless design, so it is more prone to throttle and therefore not provide as optimal results versus if it did have a fan to cool it off. So anyway, take a look at the results. Once again, the M2 did outshine the M1 Max in single core performance, going along with the same pattern as during the Geekbench test, but likewise, the M1 Max outperformed the M2 in multi-core, coming in with a score above 12,000, while the M2 only scoring 8,314 for multi. Interesting results so far, but now let's appeal to these computers' GPUs and to all my fellow gamers. So up next, we execute the GFX Metal test, a comprehensive benchmark designed to assess the graphical performance of a system by presenting visually demanding scenes on screen and evaluating the results frames per second achieved. This test provides valuable insights into the system's ability to handle complex graphics rendering tasks, demonstrating its proficiency in delivering smooth and responsive visual experiences. So anyway, I know that's a lot of tech nerd jargon. We run our four scenes on screen, and when we check the results, not surprisingly, the M1 Max completely annihilated the M2 chip. It is important to note, however, that the on-screen tests max out at their respective computers' max frame rates. What does this mean? Since the Pro models have ProMotion, they can scale up to 120 FPS, whereas the Air cannot. But even then, the M1 Max 16-inch Pro maxes out on all scenes, with its max FPS rate nearing 120. But the Air sadly doesn't attain the same accolade, falling short of its max FPS on a couple of the tests. Now, serious gamers already know that MacBooks are not the go-to choice for gaming. But for casual games or the occasional light gaming sesh, MacBooks still hold up pretty well in this regard. So continuing on with testing the GPU, we now head over to Unigine's Heaven benchmarking test, which is similar to the GFX test in that it runs through a variety of different scenes, most of which can be a bit straining on the GPU, and then gives us the average FPS as well as the minimum and maximum FPS the computer was able to attain throughout the 22 or so scenes. As you can see, the M1 Max still excels over the standard M2 chip with an average frame rate of 98.7 FPS on the 16-inch Pro, and the 15-inch M2 Air only achieving an average of 63.4. In the gaming realm, 60 FPS is like the bare minimum. So as you can see, if you plan on doing any kind of gaming on a MacBook, it's clear that any of the Max or Pro versions of Apple Silicon chips will fare much better. Okay. Last one for the GPU. This is Blender 3.6.0, a robust application that performs GPU benchmarking specifically designed to evaluate the rendering performance of a system using the Blender software engine. Unlike other tests conducted on screen, Blender benchmark runs discreetly in the background, meticulously assessing the system's GPU capabilities to handle complex rendering workloads, providing valuable metrics for comparing and optimizing performance. This is a test that is more suited towards those individuals who want to gauge at how well a machine should be able to handle any kind of rendering, especially 3D models. And once again, the M1 Max destroys the standard M2 in all three tests. But what was interesting was seeing how pitiful the M2 performed on the junk shop test, only averaging around 5 samples a minute. At first, I thought this was some kind of error, and I ran the test again just to make sure, but the results still held constant. I'm not sure why this is, but if anyone does know, please drop the explanation down in the comments section below. Okay, but benchmarks and stress tests are one thing, but what about some actual real-world results? How well do these two titans stack up against one another when performing real-world tasks? Don't worry, I gotcha. For my video editors, I made the same exact same edits on both machines and ensured that my compressor settings were also identical to ensure they are both on an even playing field. By the way, my editing software of choice is Final Cut Pro, but if you use DaVinci Resolve or Adobe Premiere Pro, this test can still give you an idea of how these two stack up against one another. So, this project was 20 minutes long. Again, same edits, and the results surprised me a bit. The M1 Max exported the same project in about half the time. It only took 6.5 minutes, while the M2 15-inch Air took 12 minutes and 39 seconds. This may have to do with the limitations of the Air's hardware, what with it having a fanless design, as exporting videos definitely strains your computer's chipset quite a bit. For content creators or anybody needing to video edit for their job, time is money. And if you want to be as productive as possible, you may want to look at Macs with either a M Pro or M Max chip. Okay, and then for my photographers, editing and exporting mass collections of photos is pretty common. So this time I crank up Adobe Lightroom, copy and paste the same settings onto 600 images, and then export all 600 JPEGs. I still do a bit of photography on the side, and many of my photographers already know that at events like weddings, it's not uncommon to take 1,000+ images plus some video. So again, if this is your profession or if you do it for a hobby, it's important to invest in a machine that can export all your work in a timely fashion. So, once it was all said and done, again, the M1 Max chip outpaces the M2, exporting all the images in only 8 minutes and 7 seconds, whereas the standard M2 Air took a little bit longer doing the same job in 13 minutes and 20 seconds, more than 5 minutes slower. Now, this was only 600 images, but if you start to visualize compounding the work to maybe more than 2,500 images, you can start to see how much time you can save by correctly assessing and choosing an appropriate chipset configuration. Okay, and finally, before we wrap up, I wanted to talk a bit about disk speed, specifically the 256GB SSDs found in most modern Macs. People, avoid them like the plague. As you can see here, using Blackmagic's disk read test, the M2 Air's measly 256GB SSD delivers devastating and inconsistent results. It hovers around 700 megs a second for write speeds, if you're lucky, and is for sure gonna take you a long time transferring data in or out. Likewise, the read speed isn't that impressive either, hovering around 1,000 megabytes a second. In comparison, my 16-inch MacBook Pro is well equipped with a respectable 4TB SSD. And as you can see, it definitely delivers with read speeds exceeding well over 5,000 megabytes a second and write speeds as well reaching the high 4,000s. The reasoning for this is simple. Apple loves to cheap out and it's all about their bottom line. It's long been confirmed that the base starting storage options have considerably slower SSDs as compared to the higher spec options. So guys, if there's one thing to do when ordering a Mac is to upgrade the storage. That's my recommendation and I'll stand by it 100% of the time. The differences are just drastic. So tech heads, there you have it. What are y'all's thoughts? Did any of these results surprise you? In short, the comparison between the M1 Max 16-inch MacBook Pro and the 15-inch MacBook Air with the M2 chip reveals significant performance differences. Even though the M1 Max is a generation behind, it consistently outperforms the M2 chip in CPU and GPU performance across various benchmarks tests, including Geekbench, Cinebench R23, GFX Metal, and Blender, with it only losing to single core versus the M2. Real-world tests such as video editing and photo exporting also demonstrate the M1 Max's superior capabilities with faster export times, saving you more time and possibly some money. Moreover, the M1 Max's SSD speeds greatly surpass the slower storage of the M2 Air. Overall, the M1 Max stands as a powerful choice for professionals and power users, offering unmatched performance and efficiency compared to the M2 chip. So, long story short, if you have an M1 Pro or M1 Max machine, you definitely don't need to be upgrading to an M2, at least not yet. In the near future, I will make a video comparison between the standard M1 and the standard M2, so it's more of a direct comparison. I simply wanted to make this video for two reasons. One, I was curious to see how well my investment in my M1 Max compared versus a fresher, albeit technically inferior chip, and two, to show all of you that if you already own an M1 machine, you can still hold on to it for another 3 to 4 years before even considering an upgrade. But guys, I definitely want to hear you guys' thoughts. Like I said, coming up soon is a more apples-to-apples comparison of the 15-inch M2 Air versus the 13-inch M1 Air. Only way to not miss out is by subscribing to my channel with bell notifications. As always, stay hydrated, guys. I'm clocking off for now, but I cannot wait to catch you all in my next video.